నమస్కారం. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయ విద్యార్థులకు స్వాగతం.
హలో వ్యూయర్స్, టుడేస్ టాపిక్ ఈజ్ సోషల్ కాస్ట్ బెనిఫిట్ అనాలిసిస్. దిస్ ఈజ్ ఫర్ థర్డ్ ఇయర్ ఎంబీఏ స్టూడెంట్స్ అండ్ ద కోర్స్ రిలేటెడ్ టు దిస్ ఈజ్ ప్రాజెక్ట్ మేనేజ్మెంట్ కోర్స్. సో ది సోషల్ కాస్ట్ బెనిఫిట్ అనాలిసిస్ ఫోకసెస్ ఆన్ వేరియస్ ఇష్యూస్ వెన్ ఏ ప్రాజెక్ట్ ఈజ్ ఇంప్లిమెంటెడ్. వాట్ ఈస్ ఇట్స్ ఇంపాక్ట్ ఆన్ ద సొసైటీ, వాట్ ఈస్ ద కైండ్ ఆఫ్ కాస్ట్ ద సొసైటీ ఇన్కర్స్ అండ్ వాట్ ఆర్ ది వేరియస్ బెనిఫిట్స్ దట్ ఏ సొసైటీ ఇన్కర్స్ when a project is implemented. So we are going to discuss various topics such as what is social cost benefit analysis and what is the rationale behind implementing SCBA and what is the difference between a commercial enterprise as well as SCBA. SCBA, it is a project appraisal techniques. That means in general what happens when projects are implemented, in usually commercial enterprises evaluate the firms, evaluate the projects in terms of payback method, discounted payback method, internal rate of return, accounting rate of return, profitability index, modified internal rate of return. Those are the various techniques they use, and they see whether the project is feasible in terms of financial profitability or not. But when it comes to SCBA, SCBA is an appraisal technique. It will try to identify or select the process whether it is the project can be implemented, is it in the interest of the society or not. For that purpose, SCBA is implemented. So, in the social cost benefit analysis, the prime focus is on what is the benefit a society earns if a project, if that particular project is implemented. What is the cost it is going to pay when that project is implemented? So, the cost may be in terms of pollution, the cost may be in terms of the resources which belong to the society, the cost may be in terms of impact on the health of the maybe workers or society, or because of the pollution causing air or water pollution, earth pollution, all those kinds of things will have negative impact on the society. So, they will try to assess in terms of money or in terms of impact what it has after implementation. Similarly, there are certain kinds of benefits that are attached to a project implementation. Maybe people are engaged for employment and they continue to earn. It may also give certain kinds of benefits. For example, if a hospital is introduced, that is also a project. If a hospital is established, it is going to offer better health care to the people. So, that is a benefit to a society. Similarly, the cost can be in terms of, say, a tobacco factory is established. It may cause pollution and it is also going to cause health problems to the consumers of the such kind of products. In those cases, it is a loss or it is a cost to the society. So, we have to take all these things into consideration and try to see whether that project is socially most remunerative or not, even after implementation. When selecting the projects, there are criteria that have to be taken into consideration. First condition is project to social cost should be lesser than the social benefits. That means the benefit should outweigh the social cost so that the project can be implemented. And second condition is all other things being equal. Several projects have come up for evaluation, and then when SCBA evaluation is done, if whatever the project that is giving better benefit or better benefit to the society, in those cases such projects have to be selected. So, social cost should be lesser than social benefits while evaluating the project. In India, various financial organizations like ICICI, IFCI, IDBI uses this SCBA technique while evaluating the project. ICICI was the first bank to evaluate projects on the basis of SCBA. Later on, IDBI has also followed, and IFCA also has followed while evaluating the projects. So, when it comes to SCBA, in developing countries, resources are scarce, whereas they have an opportunity cost That means if that project is not implemented, those resources, the same resources could be used for implementing other projects. So, in order to do that, SCBA is used to, it has become an essential tool while evaluating the projects. So, social costs and social benefits are taken into consideration while evaluating the projects. However, there are various kinds of aspects or factors that will be identified or that are affecting the social costs and benefits. So, the principal sources of discrepancies, though we are speaking in terms of social cost and benefit analysis, always it need not be beneficial to a society, because private enterprises are not much interested. They are only seeking financial profitability of the project, but they are not much interested in the social benefits. But government is interested in such kind of evaluation, because all the resources belong to a society, and when the resources belong to a society, the benefit should also accrue to the society, or benefit should be done to the society. But there are certain kinds of discrepancies that will emerge or emanate because of multiple factors. Maybe market imperfections that are existing in the markets, because perfect markets are only a theory or it is only idealism. But in real time practice, there are always market imperfections. Similarly, immigration restrictions are there in various countries. Otherwise, what happens? People can come from poorer countries and they are ready to work at lesser prices. That means, these immigration restrictions are preventing people or the organizations to have a production of goods at lesser cost. Whereas, these immigration restrictions are there in order to protect the local public interest. That is also one reason for causing the discrepancy. Licensing restrictions are also there, where licensing restrictions, that means the government may or may not permit certain kinds of industries for multiple reasons. Maybe in order to protect the existing domestic industry, it may not grant new permissions. That may be one thing, or maybe in the interest of society, certain kinds of companies or certain kinds of projects may not be allowed. Multiple reasons might be there, but whatever the reason it is there, it is finally resulting in some kind of discrepancies. Externalities are also one factor, where externalities indicate that it is not intentionally done, but it is an offshoot, or it has emerged because of implementation of project. Maybe the infrastructure development takes place, like railway lines, or like roads, or electricity, or water supply. Certain kinds of benefits emerge out of establishment of that project, but it was not done intentionally. But in spite of that, because of that project has come up, all this infrastructure is created, and that can be used by other people. That may say, for example, a bridge is constructed. When a bridge is constructed, maybe the activity of mobility will go up, and that may result in the increased business. So, these kind of things we call it as externalities. Similarly, because of the project has come, employment has been generated. When the employment is generated, the purchasing power of the employees will go up, and generally they will send their children for education. So, that kind of benefit is also, or it will also create awareness about education and those kind of things. That is also an aspect of externalities. Taxes and subsidies also may cause some kind of discrepancies. In order to encourage, the government grants certain kinds of tax subsidies or certain kinds of tax holidays, so that there is a balanced regional development. The government of India or state governments have identified certain areas are eligible for subsidies or tax holidays, so that development will take place, employment will be generated, purchasing power will also go up. All these kinds of things will be also resulting in some kind of discrepancies. Similarly, emphasis on savings versus consumption. So, the total income, or for example, if we say gross domestic product is a combination of total savings plus total consumption. So, if the consumption is more, savings would be less. If savings is more, then the consumption would be less. If savings is more, what happens? Consumption will be less, and there will be lesser economic activity or lesser industrial activity, which is not a positive sign. At the same time, if consumption is more and there is little money left out for savings, In those cases, what happens? Capital formation would become difficult. For that reason, too much of consumption is not desirable. At the same time, too much of saving is also not desirable. America has faced this kind of recession. President Obama has given a call to the nation, keep spending more so that economic activity will take up, so that it will, the chain kind of reaction will continue. That was the call. So, for that reason, we need to see there should be a balance in both savings and investment. That means there should be a healthy balance of how much to spend or how much to consume or how much to save. Similarly, social redistribution of resources. Whatever the resources that are available, whether they are properly distributed to the society. If they are not properly distributed, some of the sections are consuming more, or some of the sections are getting more, and some of the sections are not getting more. That will cause a problem, and that may also lead to some kind of unrest, and that is not in the interest of society's benefit. For that reason, we need to check out whether that is goal preference of policymakers. From time to time, the goal preference of policymakers have been taking place. That means, say, if, when we look at the first 5-year policy and second 5-year policy, the focus or the preference was more towards improving the agriculture, agricultural schemes, related kind of things. Even NABARD is also such kind of organization. In order to support or in order to encourage this agriculture, NABARD has come up into existence. Similarly, role of the state in the economic development. Generally, what happens, as we know, there are three types of economies, that is market oriented economy or free market economy, similarly socialist economy. Third one is mixed economy. In the free market economy, what would happen is government's interference in the business would be far, far less, almost it is insignificant. It will encourage competition so that the consumers will be benefited out of that. But intense competition will be there so that the cost would be less, the prices would be also less, so consumers are benefited. But when it comes to socialist economy, entire productive systems are under control of government. It will decide what to produce, what not to produce, how much is required for the country, or how much might be required for exports, or how much could be imported. All these aspects would be taken care by government, and it will impose such kind of restrictions, so no one can go violate those kind of restrictions. That is one aspect. In the mixed economy, partly government would also invest in productive resources, and it will also at the same time or simultaneously encourage private entrepreneurs to invest in the. But finally, every government has a responsibility to take care of the economic development. In the long run, how far it is helping the society to develop economy, how far the purchasing power of the public is increased, what is the quality of life that has increased, whether it is going forward or backward, or what is the kind of gap that exists between the rich and poor, and how much is the poverty ratio in the country. All these kinds of things have to be taken into consideration. So, when we are comparing commercial enterprises with SCBA, so there are a few differences. Generally, what happens, the financial and market values are not always on par with the social values, because financial value might be high, or market value might be high, but its social value might be less. For example, consumption of tobacco or smoking cigarettes, it will have a financial value or market value. But when we look at it from the social cost benefit analysis, it has a negative value. It is treated as taboo on one aspect. Other thing is, it is going to affect the health of smokers and also passive smokers. For that reason, it does not carry positive social benefit, it is only negative benefit. And other than that, private enterprises, they are not really interested much in the welfare of the society. They are only interested whether they will benefit out of that project commercially, or financial profitability is there or not is only their concern. So that the wealth distribution may not take place evenly, or equidistribution of wealth does not take place, which will cause a problem to a society, and at the same time, the many people will fall behind this poverty line. So this is another aspect of this kind of SEBA and national economic profitability has three aspects. Normally government investments will take place for the purpose of growth. What is the overall growth? Whether income levels are growing, whether per capita income levels are growing, purchasing powers are growing, or disposable income is growing, so quality of life is growing, all those aspects are taken care by the growth aspect. And similarly, whether equitable distribution of wealth is taking place, whatever the economic gain that is arising out of that profit, whether that is distributed equitably. When we say equitably, it is whether it is fairly distributed among all the stakeholders involved in that kind of project implementation. Otherwise, if equity distribution is not there, only few of the stakeholders are getting benefited and others are denied any kind of benefit, is going to cause problem. Similarly, whether self-reliance, this kind of project will encourage the self-reliance, or whether it is still worsening the situation. So, factors that are taken into consideration while implementing social cost benefit analysis. Social opportunity cost. Social opportunity cost indicates if the same kind of resources are not wasted or not used for this project, what would have been the best opportunities, how it would have helped the society. That is one aspect. Similarly, social imputed cost. What social imputed cost indicates is what is the value that you are attributing to this project, or how much it would cost to society. That is known as social imputed cost. Social desirable returns. What social desirable returns is, what is the desirability of society in terms of returns, what it is expecting, what they think, how this project is going to be beneficial, what are their expectations will come under SDR. Similarly, apart from these three, we have also another aspect known as socially acceptable returns. So, what is the kind of return that is acceptable by the society? For example, every project might be having some kind of benefits to a society, but it might not be socially acceptable. For example, if you take this Narmada Bachao Andolan, we are seeing the people are opposing the construction of dam because several lakhs of people have to be evacuated, which is not acceptable to the stakeholders or the people, those who are living there. Similarly, the implementation of atomic power generation plant at Kudankulam, it has also faced a lot of resistance from the public because they thought that it would harm their lives, or in the long run it may be dangerous. Because of this Chernobyl incident, people are fearing. Though we know atomic energy will generate lot of electricity, it may solve the electricity problems or power problems to the industry or for domestic use, but still it is not socially acceptable return. So, all these factors are taken into consideration while evaluating the projects. Similarly, we have what are the kinds of approaches that are used by SCBA. SCBA uses two approaches known as UNIDO, similarly little mirrorless approach, or we also call it as LM approach. So, UNIDO approach, what UNIDO indicates is United Nations Industrial Development Organization. This has evaluated, first time they have evaluated the projects on the basis of social cost benefit analysis. So, this UNIDO approach is not, however, followed in India by ICICI or IFCA or IDBA. They only use LM approach. When it comes to UNIDO approach is a stage by stage evaluation approach. There are five stages that are available. So, the first stage is trying to calculate financial profitability of the project in terms of the market values. So, that is first stage. In that case, what is the financial profitability they will be evaluating, and they will also use the techniques like payback period, discounted payback period, IRR or MIRR or ARR, profitability index. These kind of techniques are used to evaluate at the market prices. Second thing is they will try to obtain what is the net profit of that project in terms of economic prices. So this is the second stage. When we say economic prices, in the long run, how it is going to benefit the nation or benefit the society, that is known as at the economic prices, second stage. Third stage is they will try to see what is the adjustment of impact of the project on the consumption and investment of the project. This is the third stage of evaluation. Then fourth one is the adjusting the impact of project on the merit goods and demerit goods. What merit goods indicate is merit goods do the favor to the society which is healthy. For example, establishing a hospital or establishing an education institution or construction of dams or construction of or developing infrastructure or putting a power plant, all those things will help the will help the society which are known as merit goods. There might be demerit goods also, like when a project which is producing tobacco or tobacco processing or similarly certain kinds of alcohol industry is there. So it is not really doing good to society. There might be some economic value, or government might be receiving good money in terms of excise duties and taxes, but finally it is not helping the society. So that kind of impact they try to see when they are using this kind of technique. Similarly, when little Mirrlees approach is there, they have three types of factors that will be taken into consideration. One is known as economic rate of return, the other thing is known as effective rate of production, third thing is domestic resource cost. Economic rate of return takes three factors into consideration, that is social conversion factor. They use a term known as social conversion factor, which will attach different kinds of values to the aspects of a project. Land is there, building is there, electricity is there, water is there, different kinds of things are taken into consideration and they attach some kind of value to this economic rate of return. Similarly, effective rate of protection. Effective rate of protection is ERP. What it indicates is they try to find out what is the effective rate of protection factor. So here in this case, the value added at domestic prices is taken into consideration minus value added at international prices, total divided by value added by international prices, so or global prices. So this is the aspect there. If the higher the ERP, higher the better the for the society, because it is trying to protect effectively the interests of the local economy or society. That is the reason we call it as effective rate of protection. Effective rate of protection is always implemented by countries in order to protect the domestic industry. Otherwise, what happens, several global companies may come up or multinational companies may come up and they try to damage the local goods or local companies. So finally, when we are looking at SCBA, SCBA is an essential tool that has to be practiced by evaluating agencies in order to see whether that project is really helpful to society. Because the companies which are producing merit goods have to be encouraged and the companies which are producing demerit goods have to be discouraged, so that social cost benefit analysis will be useful for the society. And always it should be kept in mind, social benefits should far exceed social costs.
మా కార్యక్రమాలపై మీ సూచనలు సలహాలు తెలియజేయండి. మా చిరునామా డైరెక్టర్ ఆడియో విజువల్ ప్రొడక్షన్ అండ్ రీసెర్చ్ సెంటర్, డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ, ప్రొఫెసర్ జి రామరెడ్డి మార్క్, రోడ్ నంబర్ 46, జూబ్లీ హిల్స్, హైదరాబాద్ 500303.